Hello everyone, we're getting ready to look up today with a brand new Uplook video, tackling one of our top 10 lists. You can like the video, subscribe, and ring the bell to make sure you don't miss out on any of our future videos. Today, let's think about 10 ways to encourage missionaries. Of course, it's true that every person in the world is either a missionary or a mission field. But what we want to think specifically about are some practical ways to bolster those who have left their homes and loved ones and are serving in a cross-cultural setting. With loneliness, dangers, and demonic attacks, they could use encouragement. So let's do it. Our first on the list is to communicate with the missionaries.
Right. It's a wonderful thing in the day in which we live that we have so many options, whether emails, letters, we can do Facebook, we can have Skype calls. There are all sorts of ways to communicate, and yet it seems that missionaries rarely get contacts from the home. And it would be good for us to set this into a practice where we regularly do this, as we perhaps pray around the table for missionary families, to include them in our thinking, maybe even get our kids to write them a little note. It would be a hugely encouraging thing to them.
And number two, asking them about specific prayer requests.
Yeah, it's good to communicate how they've been an encouragement to you and that you want to be an encouragement to them. And so we can ask them about their family. Maybe their kids are at college overseas and that they need friends and support there, about their aging parents at home, as well as the family that's on the field, the challenges of their work. Sometimes we don't understand that. We think they're all cutting their way through a jungle when in fact they're in teeming cities with all sorts of problems that we don't face in our part of the world. Maybe a breakthrough that they're praying for that we can join with them and pray for that breakthrough. So this is a great way that we can work 24/7. We can actually function around the clock by praying for people on the other side of the world. So when we're going to bed, they're getting up. But because we prayed for them, we have a vested interest in their work on the other side of the field. When they go to rest, we get up to work. So it's a very efficient way to work around the clock.
And I like how it's not just praying in general for these missionaries, but finding out what specifically they need prayer for and really helping us as we pray for them. Number three, arrange a missionary meal.
This is one way to stimulate prayer interest in our local church. Maybe highlight certain countries, especially where we know missionaries. Maybe even prepare the food with that country in mind. And maybe have some young people do a little research on that country. Operation World is a great book that gives you the background of the countries, the various groups of people that are there, the amount of gospel work that's gone on in that country in the past, and what's going on at present. It's an excellent aid, Operation World. And then make sure that during the prayer time you have specific requests. Maybe everybody gets a different missionary to pray for. But make it practical, make it interesting, and make it an ongoing thing, not simply a once-in-a-lifetime event, but an ongoing thing where you're keeping the missionaries before the Christians.
And you hinted at this next one when we talked about communicating with missionaries, but number four, arrange pen pals between kids here and missionaries' kids in the field.
Right, especially at birthday time, special events. I'm sure the first Christmas when they're away from family and friends on the other side of the world, asking these other young people about their life, what's it like, and then sharing things that are happening in your life, maybe in your Sunday school or your youth group, and maybe they collect stamps. So going to the post office and picking up some nice specialty stamps to send on your letters to them. These are all things that enhance the life of these young people. Maybe finding out not only when their birthday is, but working with folks to send over some special things for the birthday, even some Smarties or M&Ms or whatever that they can't maybe get on the field. So every field is different. Some places they have access to more things than others. Some places they just need the goods for a birthday cake sent to them. So these are things that are practical, but they're, again, decorating life and making the missionary experience for these kids a happy one, because they're, in a sense, kind of conscripts. It was their parents who were called. And so to let them know that they're an important part of the missionary enterprise is a vital part for us to carry on.
And with all the methods nowadays, that becomes easier and easier, which leads us into number 5, plan a Skype or FaceTime call with your prayer group.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Now, you better check the connections first before you have a lot of people there expecting to connect. But it's a wonderful way, and sometimes it's just the local church singing a song. Ask them what's their favorite song. Sometimes they're in an isolated place. It's been a long time since they heard a group of Christians singing, and it'll be such an inspiration to them. Again, asking for specific needs and praying while you're together on the connection so that they see you and share with you maybe a few testimonies about some of the good things that are happening in your own local church back at home, and then finding out some good things there that will encourage you as well.
And number 6, contribute to tickets for an elder and his wife to visit the field.
This is certainly something that's well within the range of possibility in many sectors today. And it's good for elders who are representing their local assembly, and also these people who have been sent out by the local assembly, to have a connection like that, to go over and to actually see their needs. Because many times in the prayer letters, we don't hear about all the struggles. They're not going to tell you, my car's broken down and I don't have parts. They're not going to tell you about the unreasonable landlord who's making it very difficult for them to live, or the difficult circumstances, the dangers. They're not always going to tell you those things. And when you can have eyes on the situation, it's a great investment for the elders to be able to get over, at least one elder. And another thing too is sometimes when you're in a lonely outpost, to have someone, even for a week or two, share the ministry and do the preaching, so you can actually sit and soak it in a bit instead of always being the one who's giving until you begin to see the church develop. So that's a huge asset as well.
And number 7, provide a place for them to rest when they first return on furlough.
Of course, missionaries are eager to get out there and tell about their work, but they need a little time to rest, and a place off to themselves, maybe renting an Airbnb for them or something like that, where they can just be on their own and come and go as they wish, can be a huge asset. Making arrangements for them to have a car, a vehicle during their time here. Making special arrangements for them to have some medical attention or some dental attention. These are all things that are helpful, and maybe you can be the support person who, when they need parts or when they need funds handled, payments made here at home, you can help them with all of those things.
And number 8, keep Christians updated on world events that affect your missionaries.
Sometimes when we watch the news, we're not thinking that way. You think about missionaries who at the present time are not able to travel because of this virus problem, and they want to get back to their mission field and they can't. And there are lots of issues in the world, wars, political events, elections that may determine how much freedom the Christians have in a certain country. We should be on the front line of that. You're not going to hear that on your evening news. And so God's people need to hear this on a regular basis. Let's remember the missionaries in this country. They're having a big election coming up. We need to be praying that the right person will be in place, because it will affect the freedom of the missionaries and the Christians in that country. So let's be on top of that.
And that gives us a more heavenly perspective when we watch the news and the movement of global events. Number 9, some fields need supplies, but check first.
Exactly, because you have a situation where people will send large amounts of, say, used clothing to a certain country, and the clothing is totally inappropriate for the people there. It's a tropical land and they don't use mukluks and parkas. Sometimes you're sending stuff to people that aren't particularly used to giving out stuff to the poor. That's not their ministry. They may be in a medical mission and they actually need medical supplies. Sometimes you send materials that the missionary ends up paying a huge amount of import duties on, where they could actually buy them locally for cheaper. So it's good to communicate with the missionaries, find out what is best, how best to send these things. It's good to provide supplies, but it's got to be available and usable on that location, because otherwise it's just wasted.
And along with that, number 10, funds are helpful, but should be sent through a service group.
A lot of people don't understand this, but you just can't send, especially U.S. dollars, to many countries around the world because of the black market dealing in that currency. And so most of these missionaries will have accounts in their home country, and they will have arrangements there so that the funds can go into that account and never leave the country from which they're commended. And so we've got to understand those things. We need to be informed, because we can get them into trouble by sending foreign currency over to them when it should be left here right in their own account. So these are all things that are important. I'm sure anybody getting together with others interested in the mission field will have lots of good ideas. A lady said, "I don't have any interest in the mission field." And her friend said, "That's probably because you don't have any investment. You only get interest where you've made an investment." So I think of the words in 3 John that are so encouraging in this regard. He's speaking about those who are serving for the Lord elsewhere, and he says, "If you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you do well, because they went forth for his name's sake, taking nothing of the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such, that we may become fellow workers for the truth." This phrase, sending them forward in their journey in a manner worthy of God, actually could be translated the way you would do it if it was God who was visiting. So we want to treat these people as the Lord's special servants. We want to minister to them. They're not expecting the unbelievers to fund their own evangelism. They're looking to the Lord to provide for that, and we should be his agents in ministering to their needs so that they can throw themselves wholeheartedly into the work and not be stymied because of a lack of resources.